Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our regular meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. This is meeting number eight. Madam Clerk, would you do the roll call, please?
Chairman Groff?
Here.
Counselor Barry?
Here.
Counselor Byer?
Present.
Counselor Fritz?
Here.
Counselor Jordan?
Yeah.
Counselor McGinty?
Here.
And Counselor Reed?
Here.
The Pledge of Allegiance to the flag. All rise.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there any citizen that wishes to comment on some item that is not on the agenda tonight?
Just very quickly, Mr. Chairman, the County Budget Committee for the Cumberland County has been meeting. I've been attending these meetings, and they're having public meetings. I want the people to know, if they're interested in attending, Thursday, November 6th at 7 p.m., it will be in Naples. Wednesday, November 12th at 7 p.m. will be in Portland. And November 13th at 7 p.m. will be in Scarborough. So if any of the people are interested in that budget, that's the time to attend those, one of those three public hearings. And the town of Cape Elizabeth pays a little more than $500,000 a year to the county budget. And this year, there is a proposal to increase it a little bit. So it should be of interest to those people who keep an eye on the budget.
Are there any citizens that wish to comment on some item not on the agenda? Hearing none, move forward to presentations. This is the absolute best part of my job, is to be able to do these presentations. And let me go down to the podium. The first is the Cape Elizabeth High School boys swim team. Jordan. I see the coach. Come on up. Hey, Kerry, how are you? Cape Elizabeth Town Council resolution, Cape Elizabeth High School boys state championship swim team, 1997. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth High School boys swim team won the 1997 boys state championship swim meet, and whereas this team represents a continuation of superior achievement by our boys swimmers in regional meets as well as in statewide competition, and whereas swimming victories are the result of many hours of dedicated practices at odd times of the day and also represent achievements by many members participating in varied events, and whereas the Cape Elizabeth Town Council wishes to congratulate the finest boys swimmers in the state in winning the state championship, now, therefore, be it resolved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council that we hereby salute the 1997 Maine Boys State Championship swim team, and we thank them for all they have done to represent the great tradition of swimming excellence in Cape Elizabeth. Dated this 15th day of October in the year 1997 at Cape Elizabeth, Maine, signed by all members of the town council.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I asked my captains to be here. One of them is away at college and the other one's working, and the other members of the team, I'm sure, at home doing their academics, getting ready for the season. I'd like to thank everyone. It was a long season, it was a hard season, and after 4 years of coaching the boys team, we finally won one, so it was a nice one to bring home. So thank you for all your help, and thanks for the citizens of Cape Elizabeth. Thank you.
We have another town council resolution tonight, and it's for Ann Chapman. If you join me, Ann. Presenting this resolution is a real pleasure for me because not only have I known Ann in her public life, but I've also known Ann as a normal everyday citizen, and she certainly has done extraordinary service for this town. Cape Elizabeth Town Council Resolution, whereas Ann S. Chapman served as a member of the Cape Elizabeth School Board from June 1, 1991 to September 3, 1997, and whereas during Ann's tenure as a member of the board, she provided positive leadership that led to the total reconstruction of the town's elementary and middle schools, and whereas Ann was a strong advocate of public and parental involvement in school decision-making and continually searched for opportunities to enhance the quality of education provided in Cape Elizabeth schools, and whereas Ann worked closely with the town council in striving to maintain as low tax burdens as possible and advancing cooperation among all community departments, services, and programs, now, therefore, be it resolved by the town council that we hereby thank Ann S. Chapman for her service to the Cape Elizabeth School Department and the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, and we wish her well with her new career pursuits. Dated this 15th day of October in the year 1997 in Cape Elizabeth, Maine, signed by all members of the town council. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That's not only very flattering, but it really sums up some of the things that I'm most proud of from my time on the school board. And certainly no school board member does any of these things by themselves, but to the extent that I was a positive force, I'm certainly glad. And I'd like to thank not only the town council members who are here, but former town council members who also helped make this a positive relationship between the town council and the school board. And my family, which put up with a lot of sacrifices while I was on the board, as all of you know. And I just want to thank you very much. Thanks.
I have a couple other congratulations tonight, and these are all very special things, and I'm glad to be able to tell the people of Cape Elizabeth about these things that have happened very recently to some of our citizens and counselors, because I hope it will make you stop and think about how lucky we are to have the employees we have here at Cape Elizabeth and how lucky we are to have citizens willing to serve. On behalf of the town council, I wish to congratulate three special people on awards received this past week. First, at the Blaine House Conference on Volunteerism, Governor Angus King presented to Cheryl Parker, the director of the museum at Portland Headlight, the Governor's Award for Excellence in Volunteer Administration. Under Cheryl's leadership, the museum has grown from one volunteer in 1989 to 65 volunteers today. The volunteers staff the gift shop throughout the season, serve as greeters within the museum, as tour guides, and as gardeners. This award is truly a tribute to the exceptional work that Cheryl has done at Portland Headlight, and it is an honor as well for all the volunteers who made this recognition possible. This was an award that was applied for, or people nominated people for this award from all over Maine. And Cheryl, to be given this award is just a tremendous accomplishment for not only her, but this community. So I think you might be watching. Second, the Maine Municipal Association held their annual convention in Bangor last Thursday. At a noontime luncheon of the Maine chapter of the American Public Works Association, which was attended by Councilors Bill Beyer and John McGinty and by the town manager, our own Bob Malley was presented a plaque honoring him for exceptional service to the Maine Public Works Association. As an officer of the group and as president, Bob worked to totally revamp the organization. Bob and others organized a highway congress in Skowhegan that has enabled the group to raise their budget from about $5,000 per year to $40,000 a year without raising dues. We should make him a counselor. The presenter also indicated how helpful Bob had been to him personally in enhancing customer service and in techniques for winter maintenance. It is no surprise to us that Bob is so well thought of throughout public work circles in Maine. Bob, you're here. Come up to the podium a second. Come on. We're proud of you.
Thank you. And I do want to thank Town Manager Mike McGovern for coming, and John and Bill. It was a pleasant surprise to see them coming through the door at the restaurant. And I knew I smelled a rat at some point there. But I do appreciate their support and appreciate the Town Council's support of the chapter activities. Thank you very much.
And the next congratulations really warms my heart. This is really special. The Maine Municipal Association, every year at their annual conference, has one award presented at the banquet. It's called the Ethel Kelly Award, and it recognizes a single individual statewide for long-term, selfless, and tireless dedication to a Maine community. Our own Bill Jordan was honored for his over 44 years of service to Cape Elizabeth, including 30 years on the Board of Selectmen and on the Town Council, 44 years on the Fire Department, including service as a co-founder of the Rescue Unit and as Chief of the overall department. Now, attending this ceremony, and this goes to show the high regard that this town holds Bill, were his family, of course, and friends here from Cape Elizabeth, and Councilors Fritz and Beyer and McGinty, and former councilor members Phyllis Coggeshall, Frank LaTorre, Janet McLaughlin, the town manager, the fire chief, and they even got me to go to Bangor. Well, we all in Cape Elizabeth know how much Billy's done for this town, and we don't often get a chance to tell people how much they mean to us. And this was a special night because it was an opportunity to let Billy know that we really appreciate everything he's done for this town and the example that he's helped set for people to come and serve and help their neighbors and help their community. It's great for us, Bill, and it was great for the state of Maine.
Oh, you're going to hold it?
Sure.
I'm
going to do something up here.
Oh. No, I just want to say that I am kind of dumbfounded that I would be recognized for an award of that such. But I didn't make a big speech at the ceremony, but I think I hit a couple of the high points of the time that I've served in Cape Elizabeth, from three selectmen to five and then to council. And I've seen a lot of changes over the years, and I've always supported changes that I felt would be good for the young folks. And I will continue to do that, but I only have from now until next June to take care of that. But I had to make one comment at the banquet, and I had a guy, and I'll tell you the rest of the story. I had a guy come up to me afterward and shake my hand, and he says, I'm Fort Fairfield, and I knew his uncle, and he says, I brought down three bags of potatoes from Fort Fairfield, and I had a gentleman I thought wanted the three of them, but he only wanted two. If you'd like to have that, I'll give it to you. Because I made a comment at the meal. It was a good meal. I have no complaints about the fish and what have you. But it was surprising to me to go to Bangor and not have a potato with the meal. And I made that comment, but no cooks come up to me, but there's a lot of other people. There's a lot of other people come up to me, thank me for saying. Thank you, I appreciate it.
Thank you, Bill. We'll move forward, and I'll ask if there are any other councilors with reports and/or correspondence. Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make an announcement that we have openings on many of the town's boards and commissions, and these are the standing committees. And we are accepting applications for these positions. If you'll take a look in the Cape Courier, and if you have an interest in serving the town, to please be in touch with Barbara Ray at the town hall, and her phone number is it the same as the town manager's? 799-5251, and we'll get you an application. Thank you very much.
And if Bill Jordan doesn't inspire you to volunteer, nothing will. Councilor Byer.
Thank you, Chairman Groff. I have three brief reports to make. The Maine Municipal Association Legislative Committee, of which I am the representative from this group, met on the 16th, and we received a presentation, which I think everyone would be interested in, from what is termed the Intergovernmental Task Force, which was either chaired or directed by Evan Rickett, who, as you know, was in the planning area for the governor. It was a 21-person committee, and they were making reports and recommendations. I'll just quickly touch on it because I think it will come back to us in different ways fairly quickly. First of all, the purpose of this task force was to cut property taxes, to reduce duplication among the various levels of government, including state, county, and local, to require that the legislature fund those efforts which it mandates to local government as well as county government, and to enhance communication, coordination, and cooperation among those three levels of government. Certainly no one I can think of would disagree with any of those laudatory objectives. The reforms that were proposed included trying to cut into the property tax by having the state take out of its revenues about $38 million to fund 62% of county budgets, those areas which the state has mandated that the county undertake. It also is suggesting that the county would be able to play a role of providing optional services to towns, the idea being that the towns would be the customer, if you like, for the county, and that the county might be able, through its broader responsibilities, to be helpful. That it would also set up a more professional administration at the county level to reduce duplication of service. And finally, that there be a formal communication process established among those various levels of government to enhance, as I said, cooperation and reduce overlap. The process which has been put in place calls for those counties to proceed in this direction on their own, looking forward to a referendum by county in the year 2003. I guess that's about it. I'll sum up on that one and simply say that we'll all be hearing more about that, I'm sure, as it goes along. The second of my reports is a quick update on the Maine Municipal Association convention, which Joe just referred to, which was on the 8th and 9th, and it was John McGinty and myself were there as representatives of the council, Phil McGuldrick, Bob Malley, and Mike McGovern. There were a variety over the 2 days of seminars and presentations which were given. We tried to split up among us so that we could cover them all in order to learn various things. And I will touch ever so quickly on a couple of points. There was, as an example, a report given by a statewide bicyclist group. Both Bob Malley and I were there to hear that, and it covered things that were fairly specific and in some cases fairly mundane but still useful, such as which way do you have the grates on the side of the road facing. Obviously, if you have them straight along, the bicycle wheel goes into the grate, and if you have them sideways, it doesn't. that may sound obvious, but it turns out not always to be, I guess, in reality. I will also mention the movement toward the 911 dial-in was discussed in some detail at a session that I went to that was very interesting in regard to Bangor and Brewer trying to get together on how to coordinate dispatching. Bangor was able to save almost $100,000 by coordinating it and sharing the workload, although they were still not able to get the state to participate in what really amounted to three dispatching units, all within about an arm's or baseball throw of each other in Bangor. We also went to others which regarded or included benchmarking, which is a process of trying to compare how our town does relative to the best practices of other towns. I won't cover more than that, other than to say that there were obviously a number of seminars and sessions that I think were useful to us all, and I think we brought back some ideas that will be able to be helpful here in the Cape. And the third comment I'll make quickly as a report is that the pool committee, of which I am the council's representative, has had two meetings. We had a preliminary meeting on September 11th, established a chair, David Sear, established a process by which we'd move forward. Our second meeting, which was on October 2nd, I believe, was a visitation of the pool to see essentially what's there and what needs to be fixed and what the problems are. We were also able to define our scope of function, to adopt the report that was prepared by the previous committee in regard to what the issues were, and to establish who was going to be moving forward and in what period of time. Our next meeting is November 6th, and for those of you that are interested, I'm sure there's going to be a regular write-up in the Cape Courier on that, the progress of that committee, in that there's a representative there who's taking good notes. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Moving around the table, Councilor McGinty.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. On September 2nd, the annual municipal golf tourney was held. This is a tournament that's in memory of Don Webster, who was a former fire chief here in Cape Elizabeth. It was an opportunity for all town employees across all departments, fire, planning, public works, council members, former council members, other elected officials such as Jane Amaro and Gene Gim Marvin played. It was an opportunity to get together in a social and recreational setting, to commune with each other, if you will. I'd like to thank, it's sponsored by the Cape Elizabeth Police Union, so I'd like to thank them for putting it on. They put it on every year. Also thank Papoota Club, and particularly Dan Hannigan, who works at Papoota Club and coordinates with the police union. Also like to thank the town manager, who graciously opens his home after the tournament for some libation and goodies. So thank you to the police union and all those involved in the municipal golf tournament.
John's too modest to tell you who won.
I feel like I'm set up after Billy and yeah, okay, yeah, we won the golf tournament. Okay, thanks. Moving right on. Thank you, Raymond. Thank you. Thank you. My team, that was Neil Williams and Steve Webb from South Portland and Sandy Hanscom from upstairs in the planning office.
And that team will never play again together. Are there any other reports and correspondence by any council members? Mr. McGovern.
Excluding it by any other council member. Just wanted to mention that the Monday before Election Day, which is the first Monday in November, a group's going to be getting together here in the town hall to discuss the town's web page on the internet. We currently have a page, but you know, as it's progressing, it's apparent that it can expand thousandfold. And Larry Glantz, who's a member of the Recycling Committee, has offered to help lead a discussion and to work with us to implement whatever suggestions come forward. One of the council goals this year is to look at more ways of expanding citizen and communication and public participation. So I'm really pleased that Larry has stepped forward and is willing to do this. And we'll be getting recruiting a few people who we know are definitely interested to come, but any citizen who wishes to participate would be more than welcome, very informal, and just see how we can have this evolve so that it reaches its fullest potential as time progresses.
Anyone else?
Council? I'll just comment that this evening I attended the Executive Committee of the Council of Governments, and we've had some concern about the relevance of the things that they, the services that they provide in the past, and they are going to be setting about having a study and contacting towns about what it is that we need them to do. So we'll be having considerable input.
I have one other matter. I am the town council representative on the, what we now call the Town Farm Study Committee instead of the Poor Farm. The final meeting of that committee is tomorrow night at the Town Hall Cafeteria. That, I anticipate that after that meeting, that committee will then be forwarding a report to the town council. But of course, the public is welcome at the study committee hearing. The public is welcome at any meeting of any group in this town. Do I hear a motion as to approval of previous minutes?
So moved.
I'd second it.
As printed.
There's been a first, a motion and a second for, to approve the minutes of...
Previous meeting.
I take it we need to approve two sets of minutes. Is that correct?
Workshop and meeting.
Yes.
So the minutes would be meeting 6 of September 8, 1997, and meeting 7 of October 1st, 1997. And I assume that was the intent of your motion?
My intent, yes.
All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. The next matter on the agenda is a public hearing concerning the sign ordinance amendment, Ray, the Lionsfield advertising sign concept. And for some brief introductory comments, I would turn to the head of the Ordinance Committee, Councilor Jordan.
Thank you. I won't read the whole ordinance as far as the signs go, but we have done, and I'll hit the high points of it, this is just in the Lionsfield complex that there'll be, or they feel that existing signs are not more than 540 square feet, or that advertising signage shall be allowed in the field at Lions Field Complex. Advertising signs shall be affixed to the inside of the outfield fence and shall be made of textile or plastic fabric material. Individual signs shall not exceed 3x6. That they can't have one any larger than a 3x6. And no more than 30 signs shall be allowed per field. Display of the signs shall be limited to a period from 1 week before the Little League opening day and to a week after the end of the season. And if they was in a playoff, they would be allowed to have the signs up during the playoffs. And I don't know if there's any other particulars that I can add to it, but that's basically what we redone as far as the sign ordinance.
Thank you. Are there any members of the public that wish to be heard at this time?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, councilors. I am Jim Rowe of 127 Oakhurst Road, and I am soon to be the past president of the Cape Elizabeth Little League, he said smilingly. The proposed provision, which will allow advertising signs in the, on the outfield fences at Lions Field, is tremendously important to our Little League program. Passage of the proposal will enable us to raise significant funds, which will be used in what I envision to be two principal areas. First, it will help us offset the major capital expense of the new ball field construction at Lions Field. And at least important in my view, it will help us keep our program affordable to our member families. Given the importance of the proposal to the 600-plus current Cape Elizabeth Little Leaguers and to the thousands of kids who will join our program in the years to come, I heartily urge you to approve the entry of the proposed paragraphs into the town sign ordinance. In closing, I'd just like to comment very briefly on the tremendous appreciation for the workings of our town government that my year in the Cape Elizabeth Little League as president has given me. And I mean that in a very positive way. I developed a true appreciation for the necessity to due process, of which this hearing is an integral part. and also I developed an appreciation for the presence of cooperation and compromise. People working together can do good things. Particularly, I'd like to thank Mike McGovern, Sue Weatherby, Bob Malley, and Maureen O'Meara and their staffs for the parts that they have played in making this a very positive year for the Cape Little League. I would also like to thank Councilors Fritz, McGinty, and Jordan, our Ordinance Committee, for their hard work on this particular issue, and Councilor Reed, past Councilor McLaughlin, for their unflagging advocacy of the young people of our town, and to you, Mr. Chairman, for that same support. And thank you all very much for the great work that you do. It's appreciated.
Jim. Thank you, Jim. Are there any other members of the public who wish to speak concerning this issue? Seeing none, I would close the public hearing. There can now be a discussion by the council. I would entertain a motion prior to discussion.
Point of order, Mr. Jim, do we have to take this off the table?
No, it's the next issue.
Not this one, I believe.
Oh, I'm sorry. My packet has two duplicate here. I'm sorry. Yeah. I didn't get number 55 in my packet. So, yeah. No.
I don't think you do.
I would move the adoption of the proposed amendment to the sign ordinance.
Second.
Any discussion? Councilor McGinty.
I just I'd like to add one thing, and that is that the planning staff, particularly Maureen O'Meara, picked up in the business signs or portion of the ordinance permitted signs that in the business A, B, and C sections, business signs were allowed, and they weren't allowed in the town center plan. Somehow that was inadvertently left out of the original ordinance, town center plan, and the zoning ordinance, and that has been added in to allow business signs in the town center area. And I just want to add that has nothing to do with the Lions Field complex, but that it is also a change in the ordinance amendment.
Do all councilors understand that and appreciate that? And that is an amendment to section 21-2-3. Any other comments by any councilor? Councilor Fritz.
I'd just like to comment that I am concerned about the proliferation of signs in the town, and that I am supporting this because it is limited strictly to Lions Field, and that is an area that is quite remote, so that I don't think it will be a visual disturbance in the town, but I would not like to see this proliferated to other fields within the town. So strictly this field.
If any of our advertisers are listening, that's true in one sense, but in another sense, there are lots and lots of families with little children who will see those signs all the time. So sign up now. Any other comments? Councilor Reed.
Well, I was going to say, could we ask Mr. Rowe to give us an idea of how much revenue is going to be generated by this? But I noticed we can ask you on the next item, so I'll hold that.
Any other comments? All in favor? Opposed? 7-0 in favor. We would, at this time, I would need a motion to take items number 44 and 42 off the table. Item 44 is proposal regarding revenue from advertising signs at Lions Field Complex, and item 42 is request from Cape Elizabeth Land Company for amendment to the zoning ordinance. Is there such a motion?
So moved.
A second? All in favor? 7-0. Both those items are off the table. Item 44, proposal regarding revenue from advertising signs at Lions Field Complex. Counselor Jordan.
I am one that not to project bucks too far in advance, so I'm going to yield to Jim Rowe on their projections of what the signs will do.
Thank you again. I would envision us approaching advertisers with the following plan. We would ask for a 3-year commitment at $200 per year for a sign, less, of course, the cost of creating the sign, manufacturing the sign. So given that we could sell 30 signs across the outfield, it would be 30 times 200 would be $6,000 per year, less the cost of signs, times 3 years. So that's the math that I was using. I would envision the cost of the signs to be not much more than $25 or $30 each. But they could be used, of course, for 3 years or whatever the commitment would be from the advertiser.
We felt on the committee, if I may, that it was a projection that was possibilities there. It was way out, and it was an awful low. So we feel that was a good possibility.
Councilor McGinty.
I'd like to read the policy for the benefit of people who don't know exactly what it says.
That would be fine.
It is the policy of the Town Council that the design, color, and proper maintenance of advertising signage at the Lions Field Complex shall be the responsibility of the Cape Elizabeth Little League. Revenue generated by the advertising signs shall be retained by the Cape Elizabeth Little League, one, for its general program funding, and two, to invest in the significant capital expense of a new field near the existing Lions Field. And I'll make that a motion, if it needs to be a motion.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that the Town Council adopt the policy just articulated by Councilor McGinty. Is there any discussion at this point in time? Councilor Reed.
I'd just like to commend the Little League and its leadership group for being persistent and diligent and creative in coming to this final revision. And thank you.
Any other comments? I will simply echo the comment that when people work together in good faith, good things can happen. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. The town has adopted that policy. Item 42, a request from Cape Elizabeth Land Company for amendment to the zoning ordinance. As you will recall, at our last council meeting, this motion was tabled to allow consultation by the town manager with the town attorney. And I would call on the town manager to now make a recommendation to us.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Following last month's meeting, I did confer with the town attorney on this issue. We had a discussion of the current zoning ordinance, the language within it, and it is his recommendation that this item be referred to the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board for review and a recommendation. And to wit, he did prepare a draft motion that addresses the issue, should any councilor wish to offer it.
Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, in order to ease discussion, may I offer the motion that I'd like to consider?
You may.
Whereas the Cape Elizabeth Land Company has requested the Town Council adopt an amendment to the zoning ordinance, section 19-6-4D, paragraph 1C, regarding the required standards to develop property in the Town Center District, and whereas section 19-10-3A4 of the zoning ordinance requires the Town Council to initially review all requests for zoning amendments and provide such requests may be denied by the Town Council without further action if determined by the Town Council to be A, legally faulty, B, conflicting with state law, or C, clearly contradictory to established Town Council policy. And whereas the standard sought to be amended appears In the recently adopted zoning ordinance, which underwent extensive consideration, comment, review, and hearings by various boards, committees, interested parties, and the town council over an extended period of time prior to its adoption, and wherefore the town council, without determining that the requested amendment must be sent to the planning board for its recommendation and without prejudice to its right to hereafter determine the requested amended is clearly contrary to the established town policy expressed in the currently adopted zoning ordinance, does nevertheless refer the requested amendment to the planning board for its review and recommendations.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second discussion.
Should
Councilor Berry.
This requested amended in the fourth line from the bottom, should that be amendment?
Yes.
Yes, it should. And I assume you accept that change?
Yes.
It's just a typo, but I think it should.
I understand.
Well, they pointed out that standard sought to be amended appears in the recently adopted zoning ordinance underwent extensive consideration in review and hearings over an extended period of time prior to its adoption. I think we should see a plan presented, a proposed plan of some sort presented for the use of this area, because the town center is, of course, very important to the citizens in the town, especially in this area. And I think we should see a presentation of some sort before we send it to the planning board to know what we're talking about. At this point, the town has control of that property, and according to your motion, I understand that the town council would retain control. I understand that. However, I would like to see some proposal for a plan before sending it off to the planning board rather than just sending it blindly.
May I comment, Senator?
Please.
I made this motion to refer this matter to the town attorney because I was concerned about a few things, and people in town should understand that we just don't willy-nilly get legal advice and spend money. I was concerned that the day might come where the town enters into litigation concerning this particular ordinance. I wanted the advice of the town attorney, who would be responsible, if attacked, to defend this ordinance, mm-hmm. and what he believed would be the most appropriate action to leave open all possible avenues to defend this particular ordinance. Now, if in fact we as a town council, and this is not the town attorney's view, this is my view, if in fact we as the town council did not refer this to the planning board, in my view, then we could have a very narrow court issue of whether this particular amendment was clearly contrary to established town policy. The town could very well win on that in court, or the town could lose on that. But that would only be one part of the issue. Say the town lost on that very narrow principle, and that would be a distinct hearing, then we would be right back where we are now. We would have to refer it to the planning board, and then there would be another, theoretically, another court proceeding. I'm very concerned as a taxpayer that we don't have multiple bouts of litigation concerning any item that we can avoid. And one way of avoiding this is to reserve the town council's right to say that this is clearly contrary to established town policy. This must come back to us. When it comes back to us, we would have the right, if it comes back to us, we would have the right to insist upon anything we wanted to be presented to us, Councilor Berry, at that time.
Sure.
And then if there was a court challenge, the challenge could well encompass not just a narrow issue, but a myriad of issues. And obviously I'm an attorney and I look at the dark side of everything, but I am trying to fashion something here that would allow the town to be efficient in resolving any possible issue that comes up with this ordinance. And I'm not implying that I'm of the opinion that necessarily there's ever going to be any litigation about this particular ordinance provision. I'm just trying to be careful. I did not consult with the town attorney at all on this recommendation, but I envisioned that he would draft something along this line. So that was my reason for tabling, asking the motion be tabled last time, and it's my rationale for why I will vote in favor of this draft motion at this time. Is there any other discussion?
I'd like to ask a question. How is it determined whether this is clearly contradictory to established town policy?
That's the problem, I think, that I saw, and I assume the town attorney saw, and to have litigation on that issue in a vacuum by just not referring it and not having a record and simply having a town council vote had the potential of forcing the town into what could be costly litigation without really resolving anything. And that was my concern.
I understand. Would the planning board determine whether this proposal is clearly contradictory to established town policy? Is that your thought? Or?
No, it's not my thought to tell the planning board to do anything. I think that a planning board has to follow its own rules and procedures, sure. And I would not want to say anything as a town councilor that would be interpreted as anything other than the planning board would consider this amendment like they consider any other amendment.
Well, how do we determine what is established town policy then? I guess that's my question.
Well, and what I'm suggesting is that matter by this motion at this point in time would be reserved for a later day. Councillor Fritz.
I'd like to amend this motion in two places. I'd like to, in the third whereas paragraph where it says hearings by various boards, I'd like to include including the planning board as being one of those boards specifically. And then at the very end, I would like to add that the review that the planning board does and its recommendations are within the purpose of the Cape Elizabeth Zoning Ordinance, Chapter 19, Article 1, Section 19.1.2. I think that's important to include because that's how they, I think, would evaluate whether this particular amendment or what they would like to take out of the ordinance, whether it meets our criteria. And I think that answers Councillor Berry's concern, because that purpose does talk about enhancing the value of property within the town of Cape Elizabeth as being one of the purposes of our zoning ordinances.
Is there a second to that? First of all, is there a second to that amendment? Those proposed amendments.
I'll second that.
All right. Does the presenter of the original motion accept that amendment?
Not as stated.
What would she say?
No.
No.
Well, we've had a first and second. I think that's all that's necessary. Yeah. Let's open that up for discussion at this point in time. I will gladly start. I have a problem with both amendments because I think this language was carefully drafted by our town attorney. I think it's very inappropriate for a counselor to sit and try to play lawyer. I think I understand your purpose, but I'm a big believer in what you think you do, many times you don't. And by adding specific language to a motion in this regard, I think you very well could be limiting our options rather than keeping all our options open. And I think you pick up very little and you have the potential of losing something. And that's why I am going to vote against both amendments, or if the amendments are considered as a package, vote against both. Are there other comments by other councilors?
Was this reviewed by the planning board?
Certainly, the planning board has this particular motion.
No, was the zoning ordinance, which underwent extensive consideration, and it says was comment and review and hearings by various boards, including the planning board, right? It did include the planning board that reviewed.
Well, it was.
Yes.
Yes, it was the planning board, but the planning board is encompassed. The planning board is encompassed in the.
Word various.
Words now, a hearing by various boards, and I would hate to put more emphasis on one board than another board. It just, to me, doesn't seem worthwhile, and I am.
That's why you're proposing to send it, though, now, after it's already been reviewed, right?
I'm sorry?
That is, you're now proposing to send it to the planning board, but it already has been reviewed by the planning board. Is that right?
This motion hasn't been reviewed. The underline in the paragraph, the planning board, I think, in a general sense, reviewed this, but as part of the recently adopted zoning ordinance, but so did lots of other boards. And I'm just reluctant to sit and pick out and name individual boards when, in fact, the language was, I think, purposely stated rather generally. But obviously, people can disagree. Councilor Reed.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I think that that point has to be made so that there is no confusion. Obviously, by my stumbling over some of these words, this was not my motion. This was one we requested, and I certainly hope that the town council will accept a motion drafted by our legal counsel.
Councilor, anybody else? Councilor Fritz.
I'm happy to eliminate the amendment that includes the planning board. The part that I think is the most important is that the review that the planning board does is within the purposes of the existing Cape Elizabeth zoning ordinance. The purpose of Chapter 19 is what everything under Chapter 19 falls under. If I might read this, the purpose of the ordinance is to promote the health, safety, and general welfare of the residents of Cape Elizabeth, to encourage the most appropriate use of land within the town, to promote traffic safety, to provide safety from fire and other hazards, to provide adequate light and air, to prevent overcrowding of real estate, to promote a wholesome home environment, to prevent housing development in unsanitary areas, to provide an adequate street system, to promote the coordinated development of unbuilt areas, to encourage the formation of community units, to provide an allotment of land area in new developments sufficient for all the requirements of community life, to conserve natural and cultural resources, to provide for adequate public services, and to enhance the value of property within the town. The foregoing purposes shall be implemented by establishment of the zoning ordinances adopted hereby and by compliance with all the other provisions of this ordinance. This ordinance is intended to be carried out and be consistent with the town's comprehensive plan. I mean, this is the purpose of our ordinances. So to ask them to review this without considering those purposes.
No, that we haven't. That's what you're missing. We are asking them to review this ordinance the exact same way they would review any ordinance, and that's set forth as you've just read. But to pick a particular portion and give some special instruction at this point in time, in my view, and I assume in our council's view, is inappropriate, because what we're trying to do is treat this item as any other item, but reserve to us and not the powers that we would have to not even send this to the planning board. And, you know, that's why I have a problem. The more specific, and my comment before, in attempts to get specific, sometimes you lose more than you gain. And that's my problem with the amendment. Now, again, other people could differ, and I don't think we have any difference in philosophy here. I mean, this is just a matter of procedure, as far as I can tell. Are there other comments by any other town councilor? Councilor Jordan?
I just want to say I'm satisfied with it. If it's drawn up by the town attorney, it isn't likely an old farmer would be arguing with him, so he's supposed to steer us in the right direction. If we don't, we have another look at it later on.
Any other comments? I believe first we need to vote on the...
Comment here.
Excuse me?
Comment.
Yes, Councilor McGinty.
I'm not going to support the amendment as made by Councilor Fritz. I'm reluctantly going to support the original motion. I do think that this proposed amendment is clearly contrary to the established town policy. This council is the policymaker for the town, and we enacted that zoning ordinance, and that's our town policy regarding zoning. And I think that this is clearly contrary to that. However, I'm going to rely on the advice of our town attorney and support the original motion.
Any other comments? We're now voting on the first part of the amendment. My understanding was withdrawn. Is that right, Councilor Fritz? So we're talking about the second part of your motion to amend that was seconded. All in favor? Two. Opposed? Five. The amendment's defeated. Now we're voting on the draft, or on the motion, the original motion without amendment. And I shouldn't say that. Councilor Berry did make a comment that the word amend should be amendment, and that was an accepted amendment.
It's without prejudice to our right to hereafter determine the requested amendment.
That's correct.
All right.
All in favor of the motion on the floor?
As long as we retain that right.
Six. All opposed? One. We'll now move forward to the consent agenda. Items 52, 53, 54. Is there any councilor who wishes to remove any item from the consent agenda? Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, I would not like to remove any, but I was wondering if for the public we could read what they are.
That was the next step.
Excuse me.
Item 52 is warrant for the November 4th Municipal Water District and State Referenda Election. And as always, when we have anything to do with elections, we always call on our town clerk.
Thank you, Councilor. Tuesday, November 4th, we will be going to the polls at the high school gymnasium. The polls will be open 7 a.m. until 8 p.m., assuming that this item does pass. Anyone who will not be in town, absentee ballots are now available for the election. We have an unexpired school board term that was vacated by Ann Chapman. That goes until June of 98. We have a Portland Water District trustee election. It's up, which I believe a gentleman has announced a write-in candidate for that. We share a representative with Scarborough and Gorham as well. And then, of course, we have the state referendum questions as well.
Thank you. Item 53 is a poll location, improving a poll location on Reef Road. Item 54 is set public hearing on proposed amendments to general assistance ordinance. Is there a motion to approve the consent agenda?
So moved. Move.
Second? It's been moved and seconded to approve items 52, 53, and 54. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Other items. Item 55. Receipt of the report of Two Lights Road Bikeway Pedestrian Path Design Review Committee. And I believe that committee is in attendance here tonight, is it not? Mr. Beckwith, feel free to come forward and present your report.
Thank you, Chairman Groff, members of the Town Council. As mentioned, I'm Gary Beckwith of Oakwood Road. a member and elected chairman of the Citizens Two Lights Bikeway Pedestrian Path Design Review Committee. Other members of the committee here tonight is Ann Carney. The rest of the committee has other obligations. A little bit of history about the report. I think it was back in 1994 when the town applied for and received government-funded grants for projects on Shore Road and Two Lights Road. The resulting hearings and town council actions ended with the establishment of a pedestrian bike study committee, which we call the P2 committee. I was a member of that committee. The first meeting of that committee was in June of 1995. And after some 17 meetings, we had our last meeting and presented our report May 22nd of 1996. At that time, there was a vote by the town council, I beg your pardon, by the P2 committee to turn down the Shore Road grant. That vote was 5-6. At the same time, the Two Lights Road received a yes vote of 8-3. Now, this was from the P2 committee. On September 9th, 1996, the council voted to go ahead with, they voted 4-3 to go ahead with the Two Lights Road design. And the resulting work is primarily due to the involvement, the hiring of OST associates, Steve Harding and Mike Larichelle. Mark Larichelle are here tonight. Also working with the committee was Bob Malley and Mike McGovern, our Public Works Director and Town Manager, with some advice from Chief Pickering about speed limits and controls. What you have in front of you now is, I hope you have it in front of you, is our report. And what we were able to accomplish is within the directions and parameters of the council directives back in September of 96, we have been able to accomplish, with much help, the majority of the help from the engineers. And we present to you now this report, which includes concerns of safety, concerns of aesthetics, concerns of property involvement, and overall concerns about both pedestrian, bicycle, and traffic safety. I won't go into a lot of the details. It's a simple report. It's rather straightforward. I would say that the committee met 5 times. We worked primarily from consensus. And it was a good committee, very straightforward. We did not discuss finances. We left the engineering figures to the engineers, the feet and sight distances and so forth. Nor did we report I mean, did we discuss pros or cons of doing the project? We worked with the design and what you have in front of you this evening. The major part of the report is really the map and the design that you can see how it affects each of the property owners and how the road will change and how the shoulders will lie if the project moves ahead. We were able to listen to at a public hearing on September 9th, a neighborhood meeting actually, and at that time we listened to the concerns of abutting property owners. Some of those concerns we were able to answer very positively. Others we had to listen to and do the best we could with without really many changes. But we have been able to follow the guidelines of the council set forward to us over a year ago. And what you have now is the plan in front of you and the written report. I would be happy to try to answer general questions. The technical questions I'm going to turn over to Mark and Steve, and Ann Carney might give me some support on any other questions. But we hope it's presented for your acceptance.
Well, before there are any questions, I would just like to take this opportunity on behalf of the Town Council to thank you and to thank the other members of the Design Review Committee for your time and effort. It's certainly appreciated.
Thank you.
Are there any questions? Councilor Reed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Gary. I didn't have any comments on the design report other than to say thank you very much. It appears, and I was at the public neighborhood meeting in the audience as a listener to hear what I saw was, or what could be described by some as really an unprecedented solicitation in advance of decisions for the affected people, and I want to thank you for doing that. But I'd like to ask you a question regarding your reference tonight in the narrative to the 17 meetings that you and I attended the majority of together on the P2 committee.
Yes.
Specifically, the fact that the 5-6 vote on Shore Road was ought not to pass, which of course the council voted ought not to pass, and we voted no. On the Two Lights Road, the vote was taken immediately after the Shore Road vote. With
yes.
The exact same group of people in the exact same frame of reference. Mm-hmm. And those exact same 11 people voted 8-3
yes.
in favor. Do you happen to recall, although it was 2 years ago, the reason that three people might have voted for Two Lights Road who had voted against Shore Road?
I don't, Councillor Reed, recall any reason. We did not hold that one up to much discussion at that time. The parameters of a lot of what the P2 committee went through were focused on coming down to these two previously granted projects. And I don't think when we came down to that vote that we really had reasons for our votes. So I can't help you there. Except
okay.
that it was the same evening and the same vote.
I would very much like to ask the councilors to direct their comments, if possible, to the design. Mm-hmm. I think that's the purpose tonight, is to receive this report and better understand this particular report that's now been submitted rather than any prior reports or policy issues. Are there any councillors with specific questions concerning this report and the design? Councillor Barry.
Thank you, Chairman Groff. I have two questions, and I guess probably not to bypass you at all, but probably refer them to the engineers. I wonder if you could address the degree and the manner in which you were able to have as little impact as possible in terms of the frontage of the road on each of the houses going down the road, please.
I would ask the engineers to come up to the podium so that...
one could go to the podium, one could go to the podium.
They may want to refer to the...
Maybe you want to split, just so the cameras can pick you up for the people at home.
The cable TV might try a split screen on this if you're able to.
Good evening. My name is Steve Harding. I work for Ost Associates. I have with me Mark Larichelle, also works for Ost. Mark's been instrumental in the design of the Two Lights Bikeway project. Mark's very knowledgeable with the MDOT process, and since there's federal monies involved, if the town chooses to go forward, we will need to get MDOT's approval. Basically, starting at Route 77, which is on the far right of the scroll, we start out basically holding the, would be the right-hand side of the road and pushing the bikeway to the left-hand side of the road. As you go past the Schumann property, basically on the right-hand side of the road, the Hansen property, we're trying to hold that edge. If you're familiar with the property, there's several trees, there's rock outcropping, so we'd like to hold that edge and push the expanded roadway and bikeway off to the left-hand side of the road.
Excuse me, I just want to make sure that I understand. When you say that, you're moving the center of the road, in other words.
That's correct. Basically, the road, the existing road is 21 to 24 feet wide. What we will try to do with our proposed construction was to accommodate two 11-foot wide lanes and two 4-foot wide bikeways. So we're expanding the road from 21 to 24 feet to 30 feet in width, total width, paved width.
Within the town right-of-way?
Yes.
Thank you.
Moving along, as you start to approach the Wheeler Road intersection, there's a fairly wide swath of pavement there. We can fit the bikeway within that area and accommodate the added growth. As we get past the Toothacre property across the street, we hit a ledge area onto the left-hand side of the road. We did that to try to not encroach on the Toothacre property. Their house sits pretty much right on the right-of-way, so that's what the reasoning for that. As you extend further to the south towards the park, the road center line begins to veer towards the strawberry fields, and we did that primarily to not to impact the houses on the east side of the road, which would be the Wards, the Mullins, the Holledges, I believe the Kennedys, the Sullivans, and the Poolins. The road will shift along the strawberry fields further on down, Mark. I'm moving ahead of you. As you get to the corner, we begin to come back in, although we're still pushing the road to the right-hand side. Once we make the corner by the rise, we then try to bring it back in so that we're hitting more of the existing center line and starting to take from both sides of the road. We do that. We have some intersections coming ahead of us, Jordan Farm Road, Fesden Road. We have to pretty much maintain those, and as the major problem would be the culvert crossing where the road dips down, and we want to stay right in the center to minimize the impacts there. After we go past the culvert crossing, we try to stay a little bit to the right-hand side of the road to avoid impacts as much as we can with properties on the left-hand side of the road. It would be the Berries. I'm sorry, I don't have my notes right in front of me. I'm not sure of the next two properties. Mark, can you read those off?
Anna.
And by the time we get to that point, the state of Maine owns the property all to the bottom side of the sheet. We're trying to keep our impacts on that side of the road as much as possible. We try to hold the center line and making our way up to the park entrance.
Thank you. If I understand, then you've been able to, what I'll say, weave the middle of the road so that if I'm reading this correctly, there's really only one house that's within, I'll say, less than 30 feet that has a negative impact. I believe that's correct, and I guess I wanted to applaud you for at least being able to reduce the impact in that way. and committee. I think that's meritorious. Thank you very much. If I may, I'll move to my second question, which is probably a little tougher. The entryway, I've forgotten the name of the road right there in front of you.
Fessenden.
You had moved that to be more perpendicular to enter the road, which I understood from the report was because you think a perpendicular entry is a safer way to go at it, and that's fine. My question then has to do with the entryway at the state park, which has not been done that way, and if you could discuss the best way to maintain a safe crossing for either the bikes, the traffic, whatever, but I guess I'm just thinking that there's an inconsistent approach there in terms of a perpendicular entrance.
Would I ask that you go to the mic so that...
During the design process, we looked at that intersection at the request of the committee. We, in fact, came up with some alternatives that might be considered in the future in a very general format and without going into real specifics of the intersection design. What we found was that there was a major impact on a number of the driveways and that it really changed the entire configuration of that particular intersection. Because of the volume of traffic, as that being a destination spot here, we recommended to the committee that they consider asking that it be considered in the future and be studied because that whatever we did there for a temporary improvement, we didn't think was going to totally provide you with the adequate sight distance. As we started talking, it became clear that rather than go with the two entrances, that the committee was looking more at doing it into one entrance, and that really started to get beyond the scope of what we might be able to do. The Fessenden Road area was just an area where we were able to, by taking out a little bit of pavement, provide a little bit better approach to Two Lights Road, and that was really necessitated by the lane property and the driveway right there to make sure that as we grew, I believe it's about 3 feet in that particular area, make sure that they were able to turn around and get their car off the road and be protected from cars coming out of the Fessenden Road intersection.
Do I understand you then to have said in regard to the entry to the park that it's your opinion that it will need to be addressed in a more perpendicular manner, but it's complicated by the driveways and you felt it wasn't the purview of this group to solve all those problems?
That's correct. That's correct.
I might add a little bit to that. During this project, as in any number of projects, there's always additional issues identified which would be nice to fix but aren't directly related to this project. We call it project creep. And the concern with all is we try to stick to the original focus of what we're trying to address. And if there's other issues that address, those ought to be addressed in additional projects. This particular, just looking at how the mailboxes, I don't know if you can visualize it, but there's like 20 mailboxes all on one row, and figuring out where those could go and how people could have access to them without being in the traffic and whatever, if they moved to what the committee looked at as a single entrance to Park Road instead of a double entrance, plus the additional issue of the two roads that go off the side there, McKinney Point Road and Angel, whatever it is, Road, Angel Point Road. It was another whole project, and it was felt, as Mark said, it wasn't the purview of the committee.
Are there any other questions concerning this report and or the design? Councillor Fritz.
A couple questions. You mentioned that the pavement currently varies from 21 to 24 feet. Can you show on the plan where that is?
The area down as you come off of Route 77 and go around that first curve, the area in there, the pavement narrows down to as little as 20 feet. As you proceed down the roadway past Wheeler, you start to go to an area that's in the 21, 22 foot range. And then as you move down, there are areas where it does widen out to the 24 feet and then come back in to the 21, 22 feet.
So it is that narrow width in the straightaway.
There are some narrow widths in the straightaway, that's correct. Some of it may be just that over the years, the shoulders have crawled out onto the paved areas, and so that you don't find it, or the edge is broken away, and it hasn't been, repaired.
You mentioned you're proposing 11-foot-wide traveled way.
That's correct.
Has that been approved by the Maine Department of Transportation, that's acceptable design for the use of these federal funds?
That is in accordance with their design manual for this classification of roadway, yes. They have not seen the plan, so they have not formally approved it, but it is in accordance with their design guide.
Okay, so they have not formally approved that?
No, they have not.
Okay. The other question I had had to do with the hill around Hannaford Cove. Did you consider doing anything with the elevation of that hill?
We have not made any changes to the vertical alignment. The project budget did not allow for those kinds of radical movement, and to do any kind of change to the vertical would have a much greater impact on the abutting properties, and probably the grading would not be able to be kept within the existing right-of-way at that area.
So to cut the hill down would have had impact on the abutting properties?
Yes.
Could you explain that further?
Only because you have to match the driveways back in and match the side slopes back in. If the roadway is level with the adjacent area, if we lower that area, then we have side slopes. And by even with the a 4-to-1 side slope, you start to go out quite far before you match back into grade. And our dictate was to do that work or accomplish that work within the existing right-of-way so that there'd be no adverse impact on the abutting properties. That area, the right-of-way in that particular area, narrows down to 49.5 feet, whereas before the culvert, you have a 66-foot-wide right-of-way. So the combination of lowering the grade, the impact, and the narrow right-of-way just really made that not feasible at that point.
As an engineer, I guess I'm wondering whether you think that it was, I don't know, wise direction that we were given to, that kept you confined to thinking just in terms of not getting out into out of the right-of-way, but leaving a hill that seems to me is rather is the real point of the concern for walkers and riders of bikes.
Right.
That hill is what to me makes it difficult, not the straightaway.
Right. In looking at the grade of the hill, it fell within the acceptable parameters.
What acceptable?
Not as a walker. I mean, I've.
In this particular classification of roadway, I believe that the state would allow as much as a 7% grade.
Okay, that's what that is.
And what is that grade, roughly?
I believe it's in the 6+ range, 6 to 7%.
Are there any other questions by other councilors? Councilor Jordan.
I have a couple of questions. Are the monuments in there? How wide's the road as far as we're concerned now?
There are monuments at different locations, and there are existing property irons that were located.
How wide are they?
In part of the roadway, it's 66 feet, and at the end toward the state park, it's 49.5 feet.
So there's an adequate area for a road there and the sidewalks?
There is, yes.
Bike paths?
Yes.
Okay. Now, my other question is, has Schumann been satisfied on...
I'll defer to Steve.
We've Basically, what we found through this process is that there's a portion of the Two Lights Road that's in David Schumann's part of his property, and regardless if the project goes forward, we should address that as a town should be addressed. We have talked to Mr. Schumann, and I think the latest revision of the description, which would acquire his property, has been sent to him. I'm not sure if you've heard back yet, Mike.
Yeah, the engineers met once with Mr. Schumann, developed a description based on that meeting. It went back to him. He reviewed it. He was very concerned with some of the starting points in the description, as well as another issue. As Steve mentioned, they subsequently met with him. They sent me a revised description that's been sent to the town attorney for him to review and to prepare a deed. I have read Mr. Schumann's, letter today, as well as the one in the Courier. All my meetings with him have been very cordial and very good. And, I think he's really waiting to see the revised deed. But, until such time as the town attorney has reviewed it and prepared it, it would be premature to return to him with it.
And just so the public understands that I believe, and correct me if I'm wrong, would you please, Mr. McGovern, that we are going to have to address this particular problem with Mr. Schumann regardless of what happens with this project. Is that correct?
That's correct. As Steve Harding, the town engineer, indicated, the center line of Two Lights Road is to the center line is actually part of his property. So half of Two Lights Road in a portion of a triangle that goes by his property is actually his property and not the right of way. It's a real problem.
So he's not being pushed to say yes?
I think you'd have to ask him. But I think every conversation I've had with him has been very cordial, and we've sent the engineers out every time he's had a concern, and just as soon as the town attorney returns the deed, I'll visit with him again, and
what's the latest you've talked to him?
The engineers last spoke to him, it was about a week ago.
I think we sent that over last week, so we would have talked to him sometime the beginning of last week, I believe.
Okay, I've talked to him since then, and he didn't appear to me to be very happy. And I would hope that you don't pull ahead and take it away from him. And
what I understood was the problem was that he wanted certain bearings tied into the actual language of his deed, and we're trying to accommodate him. The bearings change over time, depending on how long ago his deed was written. That would make a difference in how those are written. We've met with him and talked about the specific points that he was concerned about, and I believe we've addressed them. Like we said, the town attorney is reviewing that. We won't know until David gets a chance to look at that. But
okay. Now, my other point that I like, what you going to do with that water problem?
I'd like to say there's an excellent solution to that. Usually, we can find a good solution to take water away from the road. For those that don't know, approximately near the Poulin property, near the strawberry fields, there's a dry well, which is basically an infiltration basin that doesn't have a positive outflow. During heavy storms and during the spring thaws, the capacity of that dry well gets exceeded, and you see the surface water on the surface of the pavement. We looked at several different options. We tried to, our first thought was to bring it back to the north along towards back to Route 77, approximately 200 feet, and try to drain it behind the Mullen property. There's a pond back there. We couldn't do that. The gravity flow wouldn't allow that. We just don't have the elevation difference to accommodate that kind of a move. We then tried to go across the Poulin property. There's some wetlands back there. We thought maybe we could get back into that area. The problem with that is not only does the elevation doesn't drop off for probably several thousand feet, I'm going to say between 1,000 and 2,000 feet, there's also ledge there. So in order for us to blast either a ditch or put an enclosed pipe, it's going to be a very expensive proposition. The other options we looked at is actually going across the strawberry fields and trying to get onto the road going to Kettle Cove. Again, that was another expensive proposition. We also looked briefly at trying to bring it down to the major culvert crossing further on past Fesden. That wouldn't, because of the change in the elevation of the road, that's not possible. So what we've looked at doing now is to basically increase the capacity of the drywall and try to make that larger so that the surface water that you now see will be stored underground. Drywalls aren't the best solution, but in this case, it was either that or go to a pump station situation where we would actually pump the stormwater to a receiving area. But that brings up maintenance problems, and there's also sedimentation issues that you would need to deal with. So right now, we're looking at expanding the drywall capacity.
Okay, do you raise a road there, or do you...
No, what we would do...
It's going to still have that dip right there.
Yes, again, for some of the reasons that Mark mentioned, anytime you start changing the vertical alignment of the road, either raising it or lowering it, we have troubles tying into the property, and it also increases the cost to construct the project significantly. We would look at basically taking that drywall and tying it into another basin and possibly putting some legs off that so that there would be underground storage available in the basins and the pipe legs and the stone around it to try to accommodate some of that excess runoff.
Well, in a heavy storm there, when it's there for a few days, you're going to have, in my opinion, a pretty good drywall.
Mm-hmm. I know, it's a difficult solution, and it's obviously we'd like to gravity drain it someplace, but because of the position of the land, it's not all.
So once this project is done, then it's a town problem. Is that correct?
The town would be responsible for maintaining that system, yes.
Once it's completed?
That's correct. It was the best of my understanding.
Okay, thank you.
Councilor McGinty.
Mr. Harding, I just wanted to clarify. The drywall situation won't necessarily solve the problem.
That's
just
correct.
Maybe reduce the problem.
We're going to try to solve it, but there are no guarantees with drywalls.
Okay. I had another question, and that is, when you looked at the design of the whole Two Lights Road project, did you ever look outside of the parameters of the federal dictates for design, or did you just look at what's mandated by the federal government, basically the 4-foot-wide bikeway requirement?
We understood that the previous council had voted to go with a 4-foot-wide bikeway, but they would allow the bikeways to be reduced to 3 feet in some areas if there was a specific impact that we would try to avoid. We did work with the committee on several areas. As far as I know, we're in conformance with the federal guidelines. But, you know, knowing that DOT was going to review it, we tried to make sure that we were staying within their guidelines.
Okay, thank you.
Just amplifying that, the committee specifically did look at it at the area of the culvert, and narrowing it up to 3 feet was going to involve putting a guardrail in. The residents who were there did not want a guardrail. Instead, they worked with the residents and agreed to change the slope, as shown there, and that with the green bulges, because that's what the residents wanted. They didn't want the guardrail, so they did end up maintaining the width there, but it was something that the residents wanted in order to accomplish it. So they did, to answer your question, they did consider altering from the federal guidelines, but in the end, the citizens, they were able to accomplish within the federal guidelines because of the alternative of what the citizens
only wanted. In that one location?
I think that was really the only one.
I believe so. Is that correct, Mark? That's right. In some instances back, I believe behind Mark, we get pretty close to the wetlands or on both sides of the road. There are the federal guideline would be a 3-to-1 side slope, which means for every 3 feet horizontal, you're going to drop down 1 foot. In those areas, we dropped it down to 2-to-1 so we could touch existing grade sooner. I don't think the drop in the elevation is significant, and I don't anticipate that's going to be a problem, and we've done that in the past in DOT projects.
Are there any other questions from any other councilors? Hearing none, I would entertain a motion to set a public hearing on this report for Monday, November 10th, 1997 at 7:30 p.m. at the Town Hall and give proper notice thereof. Is there such a motion?
Second the motion.
Councilor Reed and Councilor Jordan seconded?
Yeah.
November 10th.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor? Opposed? 6-1. In favor of having a public hearing on Monday, November 10th, 1997 at 7:30 p.m. at Town Hall.
Just one more mention. That plan will be there right from now until that public hearing. So if anyone wants to come in and study the plan whenever the Town Hall is open, they're welcome to do so.
Thank you. Item 55, request for authorization to expend funds from the Riverside Cemetery Capital Improvement Fund for planning and permitting of proposed cemetery expansion. Madam Clerk.
Thank you, Chairman Groff. This item does follow your last Town Council workshop. What we are requesting is to expend funds to secure the services of Warren Saradin to implement the 1993 Riverside Master Plan. What we're looking for is specific phasing schedule for expansion of the site. When I talk about the site, I mean the current site at Spurwink Avenue. In 1993, we were able to identify the boundaries that the town does own. We're also looking to obtain more specific cost estimates and also take all the processes through town approval through the planning board site plan. What we're doing now really is planning for the future of that site. I don't want residents to panic thinking that lots are not going to be available. They are for the foreseeable future, and we just want to take the steps now to make sure that that service is available at that site.
Is there a motion by any member of the council? Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, I'll move that we authorize the town manager to contract with Moore and Saradin to prepare plans and to coordinate permitting for an expansion of the Riverside Cemetery per the September 11, 1997 proposal from the firm, with funds for the process not to exceed $30,000 and to come from the Riverside Cemetery Capital Improvement Fund.
Is there a second to the motion?
Second.
Councilor McGinty. Discussion.
So this is item 56, right?
This is item 55.
56.
No. 56. I have a typo on my one. I'm sorry. 56. You're correct. Thank you.
There's two 55s on my sheet, too.
Yeah, I'm getting late. I'm seeing too many 55s. Is there a discussion on item 56 in the pending motion? Hearing none. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Passes. Item 57, report from the Planning Board, Ray Communication Towers. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. This was originally referred to the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board back on May 5th of this year. As a result of the Telecommunications Act of 1996, all towns are required to look at what they're doing with telecommunication towers within the community. I think everyone's aware of the changing technology, and Cape Elizabeth's residents and businesses are using this technology as well as anyone else. And it raises the issue of where do you put towers. There's been a number of companies that have been before the planning board. They've looked at this. They did review it. They felt that they would really like to have an inclusive process that involved more than just the planning board, that they also involved some additional citizens, some people with some expertise in the industry, representatives of the planning board and the zoning board and the public safety folks. So their recommendation is that you set up a task force to look at this. So there's actually two items on your agenda. One is to acknowledge receipt of the report of the planning board, which doesn't take action on it, just says, yes, we received the report.
It has been received.
Yes, well, but you need to vote on that once you refer something to close the record. And the second thing is to act upon, which would be a later item, properly numbered 58, which would be act upon their proposal to actually establish this working committee, and working with Maureen O'Meara, the town planner, have a draft for you to look at as to what that committee would do, and we'll discuss that when we get to item 58.
So item 57 at this point in time is simply to acknowledge receipt of the report from the planning board. Is there such a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0 in favor.
Item 58 is proposal to establish a working committee to discuss communication towers. I believe that all councilors have been furnished with a draft charge. Is there a motion? And I would suggest that in this particular case, if someone is making a motion, they could simply reference the draft charge and basically summarize it without being trying to read the entire language. The chair will make a motion that we establish a telecommunications facility technology task force as set forth in draft charge marked as item 58, as explained by our town manager. This task force would center on the towers and also that are going to be utilized by our new communication devices, and I'm trying to be very general because I really don't know what the future holds. The task force would be 7 people, the planning board, the zoning board of appeals, and the town council, so each have one representative chosen by the respective chairs. The police and fire chiefs shall jointly recommend a representative to provide information on public safety issues. The town council, following a recommendation from the appointments committee, shall appoint 3 citizens. The task force shall appoint its own chair and secretary. The task force shall be staffed by the town planner, who should be ex officio member of the task force. The task force responsibilities, for those of you, if we pass this, that might be interested, to become familiar with the policies of the Telecommunications Act of 1996 relating to the siting of towers and satellite dishes, develop an understanding of technical siting requirements for communication facilities, review Cape Elizabeth's present regulations relating to the communication facilities, seek public input on the issues before the task force, and prepare a report to the town council no later than May 1st, 1998, with recommendations relating to the siting of communication facilities within the town of Cape Elizabeth.
Second. Thank you for being here.
Moved and seconded. Is there any discussion on this motion to establish a technology task force? Councillor.
I would like to make an amendment, if it's acceptable to you and the seconder. In the last point where it says prepare a report, I'd like to suggest that it say prepare a report which includes consideration of possible revenue to the town, and then goes on by, et cetera. The reason I make that motion is not only because I like the idea of revenue to the town, but because the cover memo refers specifically to revenue, and I don't believe this does. And this doesn't obligate them to recommend they have to do anything along those lines. It just says it be included as a thought.
I certainly accept that addition.
I do.
Accept it.
Fine.
Thank you. Unaccept it.
Is there any other discussion on this?
Yes. I would just like to know, in the hope that this committee are able to go beyond the town boundaries, because I think these towers and what have you, if you get way technology is going, I don't think every community needs a big tower. I think one, it might be in South Portland, could handle the Cape Towers and everything, and I hope they are able to go beyond the boundaries of a community.
And might I suggest, Councillor, that your comments perhaps are included in the task force responsibility where it says develop an understanding of technical siting requirements for communication facilities, which I would take to mean looking into the future and even deciding if we need one or not.
I read that, but I didn't think, I thought that was an open door of group saying it's got to be in the Cape. Right. That's why I brought the point up.
Do you believe you need an amendment or?
No, the way you interpret it, and as a lawyer, I'll back you.
I think it's a good point you make, Councilor Jordan. The federal law requires communities to make provisions of this facility, for these facilities. This committee could look at and look at the technical issues and find that, yes, we make provisions for them because technically they can be accomplished, but that technical review can in fact determine that they're not necessary within our boundaries. So, you know, we would have met the federal standard of determining how the need for the service could be addressed as opposed to the actual tower location. And that was what this committee could look at and say, yes, it can be addressed some other way. But we're mandated by federal law to make that finding.
That's what bothers me. With the feds in there, I'm concerned, and I think people are going to use that and we're going to be in Cape Elizabeth.
Is there any other discussion? Councillor Fritz.
Well, I'm just wondering whether adding some wording like to that second item, including looking at regional approaches or cooperation with other communities as a way to...
Well, I think we could add it, but I think the town manager's point was that could certainly be a technical finding, but we're still required to make some provision conceivably for a tower here, at least set some standards.
Make provisions that these services could be provided within our geographic boundaries, the services that are accomplished on towers. It doesn't require the towers to be physically located within the town. It requires provision technically for those services to be able to serve this area.
Could I suggest a practical solution to this in that we will have a member of the town council on this task force? Obviously, we have all heard the discussion here tonight, and that member of the town council can certainly relay Councillor Jordan's concerns and Councillor Fritz's concerns to this group, and I'm sure it will be well received. Is that acceptable?
Acceptable.
All in favor? Opposed? Passes 7-0. I would urge any of you at home that are interested in serving on this committee to contact Barbara Ray, and she will inform you of the process so that you can be considered by the appointments committee. I think this is a cutting-edge area, and I'm certain there's going to be some interest out there with some citizens that wish to serve in this capacity. Are there any citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda? Hearing none, I believe it's contemplated at this time that the council will go into executive session. Is there a motion in that regard? Councillor McGinty.
I move that the town council enter into executive session to discuss land acquisition and disposition, discuss two requests for hardship abatements, and to review the status of collective bargaining with the Cape Elizabeth Police Benevolent Association.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor? Opposed? It's 7-0. We will be going into executive session. It is possible that there will be town council action on items 59 and 60, which is the land acquisition disposition and the request for a hardship abatement. I can't say with any certainty whether there will be any action, but it is conceivably possible.
If so, regardless, if anyone wants to find out, the clerk will be able to inform anyone tomorrow, but it won't be televised, but it will be a matter of public record. And on the hardship one, the council will definitely be taking a vote. And on the other one, if there is a vote, we'll not only the clerk will have it, but we'll try to dispense the news to the press as well.
That's fine. Is there a motion? We're not really adjourning right now, are we?
No.
Thank you all. Have a pleasant evening.